Okay, see, we will deal about the chapter solutions. Okay, we will start from the chapter solutions. See, you know, when we hear about the solutions, it is a very common term, right? Okay, we will hear about the term solutions. Okay, then naturally, you know, there are many examples, of course. I'm sorry. Okay, so you know, provided you know, okay, there is some water, if you are putting sodium chloride, okay. So sodium chloride, you know, if you are putting into water, okay, of course that will dissolve in the water. This is nothing but a solution, right? So you know, the solution is nothing but, you know, when we are dissolving a non-bulky phase, okay, here you know the sodium chloride which is present in a little amount, okay, and water which is the bulky phase, you know. So here in this situation, you know, water we call it a solvent, which is present in excess amount. This is nothing but solute. Okay, so the component which is present in excess, that is called solvent, and the component which is present in meager amount, that is called solute. Okay, so you know, the concept of solution, it has immense applications or immense consequences in the science. So the when we hear about the term solutions, okay, commonly you know, these type of solutions in which you know the solute will be the solid and solvent will be the liquid, these type of solutions will be the one coming into our mind, right? But you know, the term solutions, it has a very broad consequences. You know, if you talk about the word, you know, see, of course, you know, the you might have heard brass and bronze, right? Brass, you know, it is what to say, copper and zinc, right? And bronze, you know, copper and tin. So this is also in fact solutions, because you know, here you know, copper, it will act as the solvent, you know, despite that it is a solid, okay, and zinc, it will act as the solute molecules, right? Okay, so again, you know, like if I am keeping some amount of water, you know, in open space, okay, I just exposed it, still we can call it as a solution. Do you know why? Because of course, you know, in the water molecules, you know, there will be oxygen or other gases that will be percolating inside the water, okay, which act as the solute molecules. So you know, the concept of solution, it is not limited to one or two things, you know, but it has immense applications or immense wide range of existence, okay. And the solutions, by definition, you know, we can say that it is homogeneous mixture of two or more components. So see, homogeneous means what? You know, if you are in the water, if you dissolve sodium chloride, okay, it is evenly distributed, right? Okay, so the sodium chloride molecules, it is widespread everywhere, okay, and you know, like the water molecule, you know, we cannot separate whether sodium chloride and water, right? So this is nothing but the homogeneous mixture. And then, you know, again, one more term please have to remember, that is binary. Bi means two, right? Okay, binary means there will be two components. For example, the solution I mentioned here, okay, so the one which is having water and, you know, okay, let it be sugar. Here, you know, sugar, it is the solute, and here this one is the water is the solvent, right? So this is an example of binary solution, because there are two components here, one is water and one is sugar. Sugar acts as the solute, okay, and water acts as the solvent, right? Okay, so this is nothing but a binary solution. In this chapter, you know, we are mostly dealing with the binary solutions only, okay. And again, you know, for your reference, okay, I will write a few examples of the solutions in which different phases are present, okay. So you know there are gaseous solutions, in which, you know, the solute will be solid, and you know, the solvent molecules we can take it as the gas, okay, which is going to be the bulk phase. You know, you might be knowing in which case, you know, the solid particles will be dispersed in the gas. See, the example is a smoke. Whenever there is a smoke, you know, that white color steps, you know, you are seeing, that is nothing but solid particles only, okay. So, you know, if I tell you that, okay, that is a camphor in example. Camphor in air, or you know, nitrogen, okay. Camphor, you know, like what we are commonly burning in the puja time, okay. When that is burning, you know, that solid particles, it will go up, okay. And you know, it will, you know, like of course, you know, when there is puja, you know, this solid particles, okay, it will be there in the air, right? So this is an example of solid in gas condition, okay. And you know, if there is a liquid in gas, okay, there are many examples out of it. You know, the liquid particles, if you go into nearby a waterfall, you know, there will be many small mist or small water particles. It will be there, it will be dispersed in the air, okay. So that is also an example of for example, you know, if I again tell you, you know, okay, so chloroform plus nitrogen gas, okay. Or else, you know, see, in the nature itself, there are plenty of examples, you know, when the evaporation happens, okay. So, you know, if small water droplets, it will be getting dispersed into the air. That is an example of, you know, the solution in which there is a liquid is the solute and gas is the solvent, okay. Let it be again, gas is the solute itself and gas is the solvent itself. Leaving an example is so easy, right? Okay, you know, like suppose, you know, if there is a condition in which, you know, you take a beaker, okay, you know, there are two gases, one is oxygen and next one is nitrogen, okay. So this is an example of gas in gas, right? Okay, here, you know, the oxygen, we know it is in, okay, suppose if you have collected all these things, you know, the atmosphere almost 72% is nitrogen, the remaining 22 or some percentage is oxygen. So, you know, the nitrogen, it acts as the solvent, and oxygen, it acts as the solute, right? Okay, so again, you know, if you are going into the examples of liquid solutions, okay, so you know, the solvent will be liquid, okay, and the solute will be solid, okay. So that is, I already told you, one best example is, you know, you know, if you are dissolving solid into liquid, okay, so take the example of water and I am dissolving sodium chloride in that, okay. Here the sodium chloride, that is nothing but solute, which is also a solid, right? And water, it is the liquid, which is also the solvent. So this is the common type of solutions. What we think it as the solutions is this type only, right? And again, you know, like if you test the liquid, you take it as a solute, and again, liquid itself is the solvent, okay. If I am giving you an example, okay, consider this case in which I am taking water and I have added ethanol, okay. So if you are adding ethanol into water, so that is again an example of a solution in which, you know, this is going to be the solute, ethanol will be the solute, okay, right? Because it is present only in little amount, water will be the solvent, okay. And you know, that is again, this is also solutions only. Now you can understand, right? It is a very broad term, it is not limited to only one particular type. Again, you know, if I am telling you gas in liquid type of solutions, okay, already I told you. See, for instance, you know, if you are keeping water outside in the atmospheric air or something, okay, and you know, you just percolated, okay, let it be through the pump, and you are filling some amount of nitrogen gas into that, okay. So you know, that is an example of here, you know, nitrogen, it will percolate, nitrogen, it will pass through the it will stay in the water. So this is here, you know, the nitrogen, you know, nitrogen it act as the solute and water it act as the solvent. Okay, so this is an example of, you know, gas in liquid type of solutions, right? Okay, and again, if I am saying you again, solid solutions. Okay, solid solutions, leaving an example is, you know, of course you know many examples in the real life itself, but you may not have heard it. Actually, the solid solutions, in many times, you know, we also call it as alloys. Okay, because, you know, one metal, it will be in bulky, it will present in bulky amount, and the next metal it will be in little amount, right? Okay, so the solid solutions, again let me write again. Okay, so the gas, let here the gas will be the solute. And solid will be the solvent, right? Okay, so leaving an example is so easy, you know, like, you know, in certain hydrogenation reactions, you know, what will happen, no? In between, okay, I can write in this way, okay, these are all solid particles. Of course, you know, if you take any solid also, you don't think that, okay, there is every space inside that is completely packed. It is not like that. There will be some amount of space, you know, it is still not packed, you know, some amount of space it will be. See, if you take a chalk piece also, you know, you can see, if you soak into water, it will still absorb some amount of water, right? Where that water is going, actually inside the chalk piece, there will be some little space will be there. Okay, the same way, here in, okay, consider this is a palladium. Okay, so, you know, this hydrogen atoms, you know, it can occupy somewhere in between the interstitial spaces. These spaces, you know, what we call it as interstitial. Inter means between. Stitial means, you know, in between the crystal lattice. Okay, interstitial spaces. Okay, so this is a, you know, an example of a gas and solid solutions. Okay, and if I am again taking liquid in solid type of solutions. Okay, so that is again same way only. Like amalgam, you might be already knowing. Amalgam, you know, if there is a metal okay, so the mercury, you know, if it is occupying somewhere in between the spaces, okay, that is called amalgam. Amalgam is, you know, when we are soaking a metal into mercury, okay, that mercury droplets, it will percolate in between the interstitial spaces, you know, that we call it as amalgam. And that is an example of mercury. As you know, it is a liquid, right? It is, even though it is a metal, it is the one and only metal which exists in the liquid state. Okay, and again, you know, again about liquid and solid in solid solutions. Okay, so this is one of the very famous one. You know, I can tell you again one example. Just give me a minute. Okay, consider brass. It is copper and zinc, right? Okay, so, you know, this is an example of a solid solution. Solid solutions, we also call it as alloy. Alloy, the term alloy, you know, we are using to represent the solid solution. See, you know, what happens here is, you know, here sometimes there are different types of alloys. Okay, sometimes, you know, okay, I will write for brass, you know, I will represent B. For zinc, for copper, I will represent Cu, and here it is Zn, right? Of course, you know, I will use the term itself, Cu, Zn, okay? Sometimes, you know, Zn, Cu, you know, like this way it will be getting arranged, like in the, where the position of a zinc was there, you know, that position, copper will come and occupy. Okay, so in a very regular and ordered pattern, these metals it will be occupying and it will form solid solutions, right? Okay, and again, now about I hope you got it. Okay, so what is the term solutions it is refers to? But for our sake, you know, we are only studying the binary solutions in which know, we will be dealing only the primary information, okay, and the primitive information. Okay, now see, one thing is, you know, when before entering into the more into the chapter, we have to know how to express the concentration terms. See, expressing concentration, it is very important in the sense, you know, sometimes, you know, if we are giving two solutions, okay, so, you know, we can say, okay, one solution it is concentrated and next solution it is a dilute, but always we cannot go into that, right? Sometimes some solution will be more concentrated, sometimes, you know, little concentrated. So of course in that time also we can say, okay, more concentrated, little concentrated, but you know, always, you know, if there are you think in this way, if there are 50 students in our class, okay, we can say that, okay, 50 students. And then again another question can come, how many boys and girls, okay? So you know, that time I can say there are this many, I have to say there are 20 boys or 30 girls. So not like I cannot say that, okay, there are many girls, there are a few boys, then again the question will come, how many or how much, okay? So in those situations, you know, we need to exactly tell how much is the concentration, we need to quantify the you know, the parameters, right? Okay, so there are many concentration terms are there in use, and it depends on the usage we will be interchangeably using. Okay, depends on the industry and application. See, one concentration term is, you know, it is called mass percentage. Mass percentage, it is also called weight by weight percentage. Okay, see, so the concept is, you know, it is really simple. Okay, so you know, you can suppose you are dissolving 2 gram of sucrose into 18 gram of water. Okay, so you know, how much is the mass percentage of sucrose here? It is 2 divided by 18 plus 2 into 100. So it is going to be 2 divided by 20 into 100, that is 10%, right? See how this value has come. Actually, this is the same way, you know, we are calculating the mass percentage. Mass percentage of a particular component, okay, let it be sucrose here. Mass percentage of one component is equal to mass of that component. For instance, in this case, you know, the which I told you, that is sucrose, right? And the total mass of solution into 100, right? So this is nothing but mass percentage. The concept is, you know, it is very simple. Okay, you know, like these are, you know, that this term, you know, it is commonly using in this you know, the industrial applications. For instance, see, the you might be knowing, you already know that bleaching powder, right? You know, like for disinfection of matter. Okay, so you know, like for that they are using 3.62 gram in 100 ml of water. Okay, so that means 3.62% mass percentage of bleaching powder they are using for the disinfection. You know, if it is using excess, you know, it will lead to unnecessary consequences, right? Okay, again, you know, like the same way, you know, mass percentage, there is again another term that is called volume percentage. See, as the name implies, volume percentage, it is you know, it refers to the volume. See, same way you take it, you have taken a beaker or something, and in that, you know, 98 ml of water will be there, and you have added 2 ml of methanol, CH3OH. Okay, so the, you know, the volume percentage, what is the volume percentage of volume percentage ethanol, I'm sorry, methanol, that is, you know, here, you know, 2 divided by 2 plus 98 into 100. So, you know, that is 2%, right? Here, you know, it is a 2% of methanol. Same way, like, you know, mass percentage. Instead of mass, you know, here we are taking volume, okay? So, the if I write it in a general equation, volume percentage is equal to volume of the component divided by total volume of the solution into 100. So that, you know, that is nothing but the volume percentage, okay? So, you know, the volume percentage also, you know, commonly in medical applications and all, like okay, if you see the label of the tonic or some type of liquid medicines, okay, you can see that is a 10 weight by volume, or sometimes, you know, 10 volume by V by V. It is actually volume percentage we used to represent by V by V, okay? So, you know, we can see that such kind of units, right? Okay, and again, another term, you know, this is also, you know, it is commonly using by the medical people, okay? So, you know, that is called a mass by volume percentage. The same way, you know, see, here actually two things it will come in. See, I will tell you, suppose, you know, if you are taking 100 ml of water, okay, here you are adding 2 gram of sodium chloride, okay. So here, you know, two things are there, right? Okay, the here the volume is 100 ml, here the mass of the solute, it is you know, it is a 2 gram, right? It is represented by W by V, weight by volume, okay. So here the mass by volume percentage is 2 divided by 100 into 100. So that is 2 weight by volume, okay. So this is mass by volume percentage. These are all, you know, like in industry or like cosmetic applications, sometimes, you know, the medical application, these are the areas, you know, these kind of units it is using, okay. And now about another unit that is called a mole fraction. So mole fraction, sometimes, you know, it is it uses in the chemical laboratory or like the reactions involving the gases, okay. Okay, we will see, or even sometimes, you know, the reactions involving the solutions, okay. So, you know, mole fraction, see, as the name implies, you know, the mole fraction, it will be always a fractional value. It will be less than 1, okay. The mole fraction value of no component, it will go beyond 1. So, see here, suppose you take, I have taken 10 mole of, okay, water, it is 10 mole, okay. I have added 0.5 mole of, okay, sorry, instead of 10, okay, I will put in a, and I have added 1 mole of sodium chloride, okay, or else, you know, 1 mole of glucose, C6H12O6, okay. So here, you know, number of moles of glucose, it is 1, number of moles of water, it is 9, okay. Let's see the mole fraction. Mole fraction, it is represented with the letter chi. The mole fraction of water, sorry, mole fraction of glucose, it is 1 divided by 9 plus 1. So it is going to be 1 divided by 10. 0.1. This is the mole fraction of glucose. Again, mole fraction of water, it is 9 divided by 1 plus 9. That is 9 divided by 10. It is 0.9. Okay. So this is the mole fraction of water. Okay. So if I write it in a general way, you know, suppose, you know, here, you know, the glucose, instead of glucose, I am taking it as A. That is a component A. And this one is the component B. I mean, water is the component B. So, you know, what is this one? Okay. The mole fraction of A, it is number of moles of A divided by number of moles of A plus number of moles of B. Mole fraction of B, it is going to be number of moles of B divided by number of moles of A plus number of moles of B. Okay. Now, if you take the sum of mole fraction of both, mole fraction of A and mole fraction of B, that is going to be, I'll write here. Okay, let's see how it will come. Number of moles of A divided by number of moles of A plus number of moles of B plus number of moles of B divided by number of moles of A plus number of moles of B. Okay, you can take the this denominator term as the as a common factor. Okay, so you know you can take 1 divided by number of moles of A plus number of moles of B into number of moles of A plus number of moles of B. Okay, so here you know it will come, these two terms it will cancel on it. Okay, it will come as 1. The sum will be 1, right? Okay, we will check whether this is right in this the case we have said. So the mole fraction of glucose plus mole fraction of water, how much it is coming? 0.1 plus 0.9, that is 1, right? So this is the case of any component, you know, always the mole fraction, it is going to sum of mole fraction of the components, it is going to be 1. Okay, so you know, like how many components it will be also. Suppose you know if there are two components, component 1 and 2, okay, mole fraction of 1 you know, then it is easy to calculate the mole fraction of 2, that is it is 1 minus mole fraction of first component. Okay, so this is the way the mole fraction it will comes into effect. So this is a really, you know, like it is a pretty simple and simple time. It is, there is no much calculations involved. Okay, now about another term which you will very frequently encounter in the chemical laboratory, okay, that is called molarity. Molarity, I repeat, rity. Okay, see the molarity is, okay, I will tell you in this way. Suppose here, you know, there is 1 liter of water. I have added 0.5 mole of NaCl. Okay, if you added 0.5 mole of NaCl into 1 liter of water, that is going to be 0.5 molar solution. Molarity is represented with the letter M. Again, if you have added 1 mole of, okay, you forget it, you added 1 mole of sucrose. Okay, so that is going to be, again, the molarity of glucose, it is 1 molar solution. Okay, so by definition, you know, the molarity is nothing but number of moles of solute dissolves in volume of the solvent only. Okay, so I know if you dissolve 10 mole into 1 liter of the solution, that is 10 molar solution. If you dissolve 5 mole of a solute into 1 liter of the solution, that is again going to be 5 molar solution. Okay, so this is what the molarity it is signifies. You know, it is nothing but, you know, how many number of moles are present in 1 liter of the solution. Okay, so what is actually number of moles? So number of moles, you know, it is weight divided by molecular weight, right? Okay, and you know, always we are not going to calculate the volume in the liter, right? Okay, like sometimes, you know, it will be in 500 ml or 200 ml. So in that situation, you know, volume, it will be, suppose if it is 500 ml, it is 1000 divided by 500. Okay, so in liter, if it is 100 ml, it is 1000 divided by, I'm sorry, okay, it is 500 divided by 1000. Okay, if it is 100 ml, okay, it is 100 divided by 1000, that is 0.1 liter, 0.5 liter. Okay, so we can substitute here, it is a number of moles. Okay, we can say, you know, weight divided by molecular weight divided by, you know, instead of volume of the solution in liter, okay, I am putting it as, okay, instead of this 500, 100 and 200 and all, okay, I am putting V. Okay, divided by V divided by 1000. Okay, so you know, it will come as weight divided by molecular weight into 1000 divided by volume. This is the molarity. So please remember this particular equation. Okay, so it will be you know, we cannot always use this particular one, and if you know this equation, okay, it is directly, simply you can substitute and calculate the molarity. Okay, and see, if I leave you one question. If you are taking 4 gram of NaOH, you know, you dissolve in 100 ml of water, what is the molarity? Okay, so you know, let's see, you know, 4 gram of NaOH, right? Okay, the molecular weight of NaOH, it is, okay, I can give you directly, it is 40. So the molarity will be, you know, it is 4 divided by molecular weight is 40, right? Okay, I will write that equation again. Weight divided by molarity will be weight divided by molecular weight into 1000 divided by volume. So it is 4 divided by 40 into 1000 divided by 100, right? So it is 4 divided by 40, it is 0.1 into 10, it is going to be 1 molar. So this is the way the molarity will be calculated. It is pretty simple, you know, like if you know the this equation, you know, directly you can put it and you can get the answer. Now about another quantity, that is called the molality. See, molality, you know, it is referring in terms of molarity, the one which I said previously, it is referring in terms of volume. Molality, it is referring the concentration in terms of the mass of the solvent, okay? It is represented with the letter small m, okay? So the molality, it is, you know, same way, you know, number of moles of the solute, you know, you dissolve in mass of the solvent. Previously the molarity, it was the volume of the solvent, right? Here the mass of the solvent in kilogram. Okay, I will tell you in another way. See, suppose, you know, you are taking 1 kilogram of water, okay, and you have added 2 moles NaCl, okay. So this is going to be 2-molar solution, okay. So again, you know, instead of NaCl, okay, you have added 1 mole of sucrose. This is going to be 1-molar solution, okay. So you know, the concept is very simple. You know, instead of the volume of the solvent, you know, here we are taking the mass of the solvent, okay. So that is it about the molality. And again, you know, if I tell you in another way, okay, so the instead of number of moles of the solute, okay, we can take number of moles is equal to weight divided by, okay, or else I will put the weight letter m. It is m mass divided by molecular weight. And you know, always the mass of the solvent we will not represent in terms of kilogram, mostly we will represent in terms of gram, right? So in that situation, okay, how to represent the gram? So gram, it will be 1000 divided by actually the weight divided by 1000, right? Suppose, you know, you are taking 100 gram. How much your kilogram? It is 100 divided by 1000. So it is going to be 0.1 kilogram, okay? So it is 500 gram. It is going to be 500 divided by 1000. It is going to be 0.5 kilogram, okay? So, you know, if I put it, okay, divided by, you know, okay, if I put it here, you know, like the molality is equal to mass divided by mass of the solute divided by molecular weight into, divided by, you know, it is mass of the solvent in kilogram, right? Okay, so you know, instead of that, it is weight divided by 1000, right? Okay, so it will be mass divided by molecular weight into 1000 divided by weight of the solvent. Okay, so this is going to be the molality. Please remember this particular equation in the same way you remember the previous equation for a molarity. Okay, so okay, here I will go into one calculation. Okay, see, suppose I have given you 30 gram of sucrose. Okay, 30 gram of sucrose, and you dissolve it in 5 kilogram of water. Okay, let it be. Okay, sorry, instead of sucrose, okay, let it be. I will give you glucose, C6H12O6. Okay, so the molecular weight of glucose, it is 180 gram. My question is, how much is the molality? How much is the molality you need to know? See, the molality is 5 I can directly substitute here. It is molality. Okay, you have added, you know, 5 kilogram of water was there. You have added, you know, like 30 gram of sucrose into that, glucose into that, right? Molality is equal to, what is the mass of glucose? It is 30, right? 30 divided by molecular weight is equal to 180 into 1000 divided by, you know, the weight of the solvent, it is 5 kilogram. So, right, so that is nothing but 5000